Hey, what's up, everybody? Shady here, back with chapter four. It's titled Facing the Storm. I would just like to thank everybody who has followed along. And it's not really about the numbers for me, even if one person watched this and it helped in some way. I can testify that Heavenly Father knows us. And that he is waiting for us to come to him and search for him diligently, and that he will open our minds to things that we couldn't even have fathomed on our own. But this is chapter four, Facing the Storm. If you haven't watched any of the videos, please go to the channel and watch and catch up all the way to chapter four. And I'm just super grateful. If you feel like it, hit the like button, hit the subscribe button so you can get all the latest videos as soon as they come out. I put out one once a week, every 5 days, something like that. But, and if not, I mean, I still come to work. It's not about subscribers. I ain't trying to get paid from YouTube. I ain't come YouTube famous, nothing like that. So, chapter four, Facing the Storm. So this is a kind of takes off from chapter two, right before the storm. I mean, chapter one before the storm comes. So, like I said, if you haven't checked it out, go check it out. All right, so chapter four, Facing the Storm. When God had brought me to the desert, I felt it had been to strip me of my fears and of what angered me, all my hurts and pains. As I watched the storm coming, I was almost sure that I was staring at all the things that God had taken from me, and He had turned it into this storm that was bearing down on me. Right before the storm hit me, I asked God to be with me and to guide me. The feeling inside me grew. This feeling was so strong at that moment. I had the courage and strength to face the storm and walk into it. When the massive wall of sand came upon me, I felt the full impact of the wind. I was instantly blinded by the amount of sand in the sandstorm. I could not see anything. I tried to shield my eyes, but the wind blew sand in between the cracks of my fingers, up my nose, into my mouth. It was impossible to stop it. I realized I had stopped walking to fend off the sand, but it was useless. So I gathered all the energy I could gather and I walked. It was like walking underwater in a current, you know. And the force of the wind and sand seemed to come from every angle in every direction. I would brace myself and walk in the direction I felt that pull from. But the wind and sand was so distracting and so frustrating, I soon lost my internal compass. The full force of the sandstorm was unknown to me. I had not expected it to be like this. The sand was piling up around me as if it was ready to claim me as its prey. I could feel my legs getting buried. I had to wrestle my legs out of the sand. I knew I had to keep moving, or else I would be buried alive before my journey was done. So I took off my shirt and I tied it around my face to stop and block the pummeling sand from entering my mouth and nose so I can breathe and gather myself. When I had done that, I was able to focus myself more and find my internal compass. It had never left me. So with all the strength I had, I walked on while getting blown around by powerful gusts of wind. I was scared. I was not ready to give up though. So I walked, and for a long time, walking was all I could do. My eyes were closed, but I knew the way. I felt the way. Soon, thoughts of giving up on this journey began to surface from the depths of my heart. I asked myself, why was I doing this to myself? It felt as if the storm had been synced up with those feelings, because with every thought of anger or frustration, The wind and sand would gain intensity and force. It would batter me even harder with gusts of wind and sand. It wanted to beat the internal compass and me to the ground. When my thoughts and feelings were worn down, the storm, at that point, reached its maximum power. A huge gust of wind hit me and grabbed a hold of me. It lifted me up and slammed me back down to the ground. My shirt, which tied around my face, was torn off. It seemed that the storm saw its chance to demolish me as another gust of wind and sand hit me from every direction. It lifted me up again, higher into the air, and slammed me down. I opened my mouth to yell desperately for help, but my mouth was quickly filled with sand. I was terrified that I was going to die, that I was never going to see my children again. It made me think of all the moments I had taken for granted. It made me think of my wife and the first time I had seen her, of all the hopes I had destroyed with pride and anger. The wind picked me up and I felt that it had carried me a great distance. My eternal compass was gone. All that was left were my fears and pains, all of my lost dreams, all of my lost hopes. The wind picked me up and carried me as if I was lifeless. It would toss me in one direction and another gust of wind would slam into me. I was at the mercy of this storm. The wind carried me and would not put me down. I could not walk or feel the ground. I could not see or hear anything other than the sound of wind and sand. I was about to give up when I felt the wind grab me and slam me down with such force it knocked the breath out of me. This huge amount of pressure was holding me down to the ground as if the wind had chained me down. I could not move, and the pressure only increased if I tried. And what I began to do, I had not done in a very long time. Besides that night of the Las Vegas shooting, and I began to cry. The tears just came out and were quickly absorbed in the sand. That made no difference to me because my tears still came and I cried. I cried for myself, for everyone I had wronged. I cried in great, big, uncontrollable sobs. It was as though my heart was shedding its last layers of defense it had always used to protect itself. The storm had taken everything from me. I cried for all that had trickled up from the depths of my own very soul, for all the things I had hidden at the very core of me, and all that was left was this crying man lost in a sandstorm in the middle of a desert. I cried for a long time. I did not say a thing. My sobs and cries said it all. It said what I could not say. The more I cried, the less pressure I felt bearing down on me. I poured my heart out to God. It felt like crying was my body's way of purging itself, its way of speaking. I cried for my childhood. I cried for the childhood that I felt was taken from me. I cried for my father, who I had hated for so long and had treated badly. I cried for my brothers, whom I had grown apart and distant from. I cried for the relationship I had with my mother and for all the hurtful things I used to tell her to make her hurt as I was hurting. I cried because I hated who I had become. I cried for my wife and our marriage and for all the time we had wasted in our pride, fears, and angers. I cried for the coldness in my heart. I cried for all the years and for all the wasted time. I had hidden myself from the world because I was scared and insecure. I was insecure about who I was and who I was not. I cried for this man who was lying down in the desert because I did not know him. I never knew him. After some time had passed, I realized the wind had released me, and I pulled my face out of the sand. I tried squinting to see, but the storm was still strong and thick with sand. I managed to sit up, and I offered my heart to God. I poured my heart, mind, body, and soul out to Him. I asked Him to create a space for me to pray and to meditate on Him. I prayed with my eyes closed. To my amazement, I felt the wind and sand cease to hit me, as if the storm had stopped. I opened my eyes slowly, unsure of what I was going to see. I was then filled with wonder and awe as I looked around at what seemed to be a force field of energy that was circling me, as though I was trapped inside of a huge bubble. I could clearly see the storm still raged on the outside of it. I could almost feel the pressure of wind hitting the bubble I was in. I could feel vibrations from the storm outside, yet the inside remained firm and steady. I sat there and I wept and I thanked God. I prayed and I prayed with all of my heart for what seemed like hours. And time was strange in the desert. I had no grasp of time. I had meditated for 2 hours in my home while sitting on my couch. When I entered the storm, although it seemed like I had spent an eternity in it, my body was tired, and I felt my body begin to drift off to sleep on the couch. Right as I felt my chin touch my chest, I was doing this, like, but right when I felt my chin touch my chest, the force field disappeared, and I was hit by the storm again. It was so powerful, it not only rocked my body in the desert, it rocked my body on the couch. It hit so hard, it snapped me back into the world I was born into. I looked around the couch in the living room. Half of me was expecting to see sand. My wife and kids were at my mother-in-law's house. They decided to go there because of the arguing that was going on between my wife and I. After all these months had passed, I still had not told my wife that God had taken me to the desert. In fact, I told her the opposite of that, and told her that what she had was not a vision. In fact, I said it must have been a dream. I had taken what she had said and made her feel like she was crazy. All the while, I was really in the desert and had been there since she had first mentioned it. I did not know how to tell her that what she had said was true. I feared my wife's wrath. I had been stuck in a hole I had dug and did not know how to get myself out of it. I wanted to trust her with this, but we were having so many problems. I did not trust her or myself yet, and my mind was still processing everything. I decided to go over to my mother-in-law's home, where my wife was, and talk to her. I wanted to get there and pray to God, to ask Him for guidance. I had no faith in myself to think or to do the right thing for us. I had a plan, though. I would go there and pray and meditate and ask God to guide me. So I got ready and drove to my mother-in-law's with the desert still on my mind. Little did I know, though, that it was not my plan. It was God's, and His plan was greater. So that's the end of chapter 4. And, you know, being in the desert at that time, just, it rocked me to my core. All these layers that we get built up in were just taken from me. You know, and it gave me a chance to look at everything. You know, I didn't even know who I was when I looked at myself crying in this desert. Like, I was so disconnected from my own self, and I didn't even know it. You know, we grew up thinking that, you know, with life building us up, with our upbringing in childhood, with our parents, with life, with friends, everything, TV, music, social media, everything that brings us in, we learn from, that we get built up in, you know, but it's not who we are. You know, you can ask somebody, who are you? And they can say, well, I'm an electrician. Well, that's not who you are. That's what you do, you know. But there's, for me, there was no difference between that. You know, if someone asked me, like, who did you see in the mirror? You know, my wife asked me that when we first met, and it was just like the hardest question for me, because I didn't know how to answer it, you know, it showed how disconnected I was from my own self. My thoughts were disconnected from my body, from my heart. My heart and mind weren't on the same page, you know, and it was after all these things had been taken from me, like all these wrongs, all these angers and hurts, and I was crying for them all, like, you know, I was like, well, what do I have then? I'm not happy. I don't have no purpose in life. What the heck do I have now? I'm crying in this desert, you know, like, who the hell am I? You know, and it was at this point that it really, when I prayed in this bubble thing that I was in, I just prayed to Heavenly Father crying because I had felt like, now I have a chance. I know that Heavenly Father has me here. He gave me a reason to be here, a purpose. You know, and that's something I never had. All right, walk through this desert, and then this tree, this U-shaped tree sticking out of the ground. I didn't have a clue as to what any of it meant. But knowing that He put me there gave me something I never had. You know, and knowing that He was guiding me the whole time, you know, it rocked me to my core. You know, just the amount of levels that He was working with me at, and to the depth of each level, it was just so profound. It was so amazing, so huge, that it's still working on me today and my understanding. But the next chapter, when I get to my mother-in-law's house with my wife, things just, God's plan was so huge, like the extraordinary things that He has put in my path with my wife and given us things to confirm it. Like, in the next chapter is chapter 5, and it's called Warning Sign. And He gives us a warning that something is coming and we need to prepare for it. You know, He even tells us what it is, you know, and I don't want to give anything away. You know, I want you to follow along this journey, because it just doesn't end, you know. And to say that visions only happened in the Bible, or that miracles only happened in Jerusalem back 2,000 years ago, is false. It is happening to this day, and this story is proof. Don't trust me. Pray to Heavenly Father. Follow the story and ask Him if it's true, with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, and you will feel the answer. If you not hear it, it will come to you. I believe it wholeheartedly. And like I've said before, no one can take it from me. It is what the Lord has built me up on. And it is so strong that I give it out freely to everybody who will listen. Take it or not. It is my own. It is my wife and I's. And I'm so grateful for everybody who is watching or continue to watch. Please share it, like it, subscribe it, share it on Facebook, share it with your friends, show whoever you possibly can. You know, if you have a comment, leave a comment. I'll get back to you, or my wife will. We are open books. But I just thank you guys for everything. And until the next chapter, I'll see you then. God bless you, and we love you.